This is King Vidor speaking. At present, I spend much time on my ranch in Central California. The long vistas are inspiring. Mostly, I feel far removed from the hustle and bustle of the Hollywood scene. But occasionally, I am brought up with some vivid reminder of the long career I enjoyed as a filmmaker. Today is especially fruitful. A reward came in the form of a letter. It was from my favorite American painter, Andrew Wyeth. He wrote that the strongest single influence on his paintings had been my film, The Big Parade. I immediately telephoned him and suggested that I come back to Pennsylvania if he would talk further about what he had written me. He said he would be happy to. Soon I was on my way. I made The Big Parade in 1925. It was a tremendous success, both critically and at the box office. At one theater in New York, it ran for 2 years and took in $1.5 million. It was the first film about World War I told from the viewpoint of an enlisted man. Jim Appison, son of a wealthy family, was neither pacifist nor patriot, but was swept along by the larger dimensions of the conflict. While billeted in a French village, he fell in love with a native girl who openly expressed her love for him when it came time for him to move up to the front. Jim also developed a close friendship with two buddies, Bula, Brooklyn bartender, and Slim, a high-rise riveter. In their first baptism of fire, Slim was killed, and Jim suffered a wound which later necessitated the amputation of his left leg. At war's end, when Jim returned to his family and girl next door sweetheart, he realized that his tragic wartime experiences had made his civilian life seem superficial and shallow. As soon as he could, he returned to France to seek out the girl who now seemed to be such a vital part of his life. The village of Chad's Ford is located in Delaware County, Pennsylvania, about 30 miles southwest of Philadelphia. It is historically significant because the Battle of Brandywine was fought there. In this battle, George Washington was defeated by the British, who then moved on to occupy Philadelphia. Along the road leading to the Wyeth Farm, I could sense in the still remaining colonial facades of the homes the ghosts of Washington, of Lafayette, Cornwallis, Sullivan. As I entered the farm, the gentle flow of the Brandywine River greeted me. In early American history, a battlefield. Now its serenity sounded a welcome. I sensed the environment, the colors that spoke so brilliantly in Wyeth's paintings.
Hello, Mr. Wyeth.
Oh, I've been expecting you, Peter.
Wonderful.
Terrific.
Come on in.
My goodness.
This is great.
Often I had heard filmmakers talk of the influence that famous artists had had upon their films. To my knowledge, this was the first time that a great artist had agreed to talk of the influence that a movie had had upon his work.
Well, you know, I've seen that film probably about 180 times.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
And no exaggeration.
Right, right.
And I first saw it, I think I was 8 years old, saw it in Wilmington, Delaware. My father took me there with my sisters and brothers. brother, and I don't think this film made such a deep impression on me that it sort of got into my bloodstream. And it's had an influence on me that's... I don't think... It's very hard for me to... It's just natural to me.
Yeah, it's a mood, sort of.
It's, huh? A mood.
Yeah, a mood that you accepted.
That's right.
And thought this is a... It's a kind of a strong, courageous mood, and just generally...
I looked at early rotogravure sections that my father had saved of the First World War, which he kept in his studio in the drawers up there, and it all tied up with your film. And as I matured, these things came back subtly in my subconscious mind. And I didn't realize it until Betsy pointed out in certain, when I first showed her the film, she had never seen the film. And I showed her the film, she said, "My God, there's your painting, Winter 1946. There's this, there's that." And I realized that subconsciously, this film of yours, it had this effect on me.
I was no doubt influenced by many of your paintings.
Oh, I doubt that. No, I think you're just being nice.
I'm not being nice. If you don't think I'd steal from some of your paintings or being influenced, and I'm going to run through all of my pictures and I'm going to pick out the paintings of yours.
You couldn't know, because not when I was 8 years old.
Oh, no, not when you're eight, but I met a few pictures when you were a little older than that.
I realize that.
The big parade, didn't
yeah, no, I didn't stop that. And when I was looking at the picture today, and I saw, I guess it was Rennie Underwood coming down the hill.
That's right.
And she was coming down the hill, and then this sort of, just such shape of that hill. And then I went back to the hill you showed to me, on the kind of farm it is.
That's right.
And I thought, by gosh, that's true. It's just that thing there. And no, that's your painting. What's it called? The boy running down.
Yeah, it's
hill?
Called Winter 1940.
With the boy running down there.
46.
Hill?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, I saw while watching the film the connection.
But there's another one too called Snow Flurries.
Snow Flurries.
Which is just.
Just a hill.
A massive bare hill.
Yes, that's
if
like.
If you remember
that
when you shot John Gilbert, just as he starts coming
yes,
down.
Yes, I do, the long
shot. This huge hill.
The long shot, yes, I do know.
Well, in one very important temper of my husband's called Snow Flurries, you see just that massiveness.
Yes.
And also, there's a painting I did called The Patriot.
Yes.
Of the First World War soldier. And we sat in his sawmill, Mr. Klein and myself, and I brought up the big parade. And he said, "Oh yes, that's one of the great films of all time on the First World War." And there again, the fact of his uniform and the sharpshooter. If you notice this, which is used in the big parade, remember the sharpshooter insignia?
They put the
no, no.
Well, they put when they read the letter.
Yeah. They read the letter, yeah. Yeah. And there it is.
Right. And in the film, there's a fellow that has done wrong by a French girl.
You mean knocked her up?
Yeah, I mean knocked out. Thank you for the right word. I couldn't think of that word. I just couldn't come to me. I'm so back when the days of censorship that I, you know, that just kind of faded out for a minute. The fellow that knocked up the French girl, and he reads the letter. And then they put the sharpshooter thing on there.
That's right.
That struck you.
That's maybe right.
By then you were about 16 years old.
That's right. At 16 it does strike you.
Yeah, it does. The thing is that instead of, I know I'm the same way, and sometimes you forget where the, but you saw the big parade, you said it was like 12, 15, 20 times.
So. Are you kidding? Mr. Reeder, 180 times.
180?
He said it, and I think you should give him the sharpshooter medal.
Yeah, I'm going to get a gold medal struck off of you. I'm going to pin it on
you. No, I don't need any gold medal. Anyone needs a gold medal, it's you.
Yeah, sharpshooter. Sharpshooter, Andy of the big parade thing.
But let me state here, seriously. If you look at my painting, I'm not too certain whether that medal of the sharpshooter hanging on the chest of Ralph Klein isn't probably, to me, a most important, probably the most important thing in the whole picture. In that there was something when I looked at that on his chest that seemed to express many things to me. And I remember looking at the thing and very quickly painting it in. And then he had to leave. He had to go down and work in the sawmill. I took his tunic, stuffed it full of some pillows, put it on a chair, hung the sharpshooter medal on, and very carefully painted that in.
Wonderful, yeah.
Because to me it was symbolic of something that I at the time didn't realize. And all of a sudden, it dawned on me, of course. It was part of my own life as a child. It epitomized my whole feeling, and that is a reason for painting. Rembrandt would spend a lot of time on a piece of jewelry and make a man's face under a broad Dutch hat disappear, and a brooch would gleam. Do you see what I mean?
That's wonderful.
You have to bring out something that interests you.
Yes.
And sometimes it shocks a sitter because they think it's a glamorous face and it ends up to be a brooch on their chest.
It reminds me of what I've heard sometimes. They use the word metaphor. Which means that you use one image to express some other ideas.
Absolutely.
What else? If you took the ideas and expressed them right on the nose, as it were, then people might reject them and they might turn away.
That's right.
But you take one image that's pleasing to someone or that they'll accept, to help whether it's pleasing or not, but they'll accept it, but you're saying something else with it. Now, I heard that talked of a few days ago with students who study films, and I know that's what goes on with all of your paintings. You can't just look at it and say it's a girl in front of a house or something. It has another meaning, but the way to tell the other meaning has come to you with these figures and these images that you're using. And that's what you're saying about sharpshooter, too.
I've been reading over a doctorate's thesis written on my husband, in which final summation is that he's a metaphoric realist. And I realized today, when I finished looking at the big parade, you're a master of metaphor. My husband's a master of metaphor.
And don't forget Robert Frost.
Robert Frost.
Yeah.
We have a poet, an artist, and a great director that are masters of American metaphor. Just possibly this is a unique American achievement.
That's interesting. And I didn't, the only thing I thought of in the early days of my work, I thought that everything looked to be exaggerated. And I thought, I want to make the pictures not look so exaggerated, ham acting, 10, 20, 30, that they call it. I want it to look real, but not be real. You know that? And if anybody...
To look real, but not be real.
Yeah. If anybody they used to put with me technical directors, and they put a doctor. I was in England doing the Citadel, in the army, in the big parade. They'd put officers, and they'd say, "That isn't the way it happened." You know, I have a thing in there, tack formation, and there's no such thing as a tack formation. I made that up. So they'd say, "This isn't the way it was," and I said, "Don't tell me." It absolutely rubbed me the wrong way. It's like somebody standing over your shoulder and say, "That isn't the way it is," or something like that.
Winston Churchill says in the history of the English-speaking people about the Ballad of King Arthur and the great stories that have been handed down for generations, they might not be true, but you know they are true. And if they didn't happen, they should have happened.
That's wonderful.
Isn't that great?
Yeah,
that expresses great. The whole thing.
It does. So that the metaphor... I know that's what happens. People see in it more, and that was the great thing with silent pictures. You could write your own dialogue. You could write.
Well, now I don't want to interrupt here, but I want to make this statement. I think that's the great difference that makes the big parade a classic film. Now, I've seen it many times. I know the story. There's nothing shocking about the story after seeing it 180 times. But this strange quality that you can't define, which is a metaphor,
yes,
is in almost every shot in that film, even to the beginning of the film, which today many people would say is stilted, the way Hobart Bosworth walks across the floor and all of a sudden comes to a stop and looks. The silence of that early part of that film brings out the power of the action of the later reels.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's the difference that makes all the difference.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, that's interesting. You've seen it enough times to each time the meaning back of it comes
out. That's it. It's symbolic.
Yes.
Now, a lot of people say, well, Andy, why do you look at this film so many times? I don't understand it. Well, of course, all I can think of, well, Christ, they don't understand my painting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, that's interesting. Let's pause for station announcements.
During the night, as if to give a visiting Californian the full treatment, the Pennsylvania skies opened up and painted the countryside a resplendent white. The Kerner farm is in walking distance of the Wyeth home. These surroundings have been an inspiration to Wyeth for over 40 years, resulting in some 450 pre-sketches, watercolors, and paintings.
This is a hill at Kerner's Hill, which I've always tied up with your film, The Big Parade,
Mr. Peter. You know, I can recognize the end of the picture. The last time I saw the picture, I was struck. I mean, I see immediately the association.
All it needs is John Gilbert coming over the top with one leg.
And where the other way, waiting.
That's
waiting
right,
down
that's
at the
right.
Bottom, and a mother, huh?
Yep.
It has the same contour, doesn't it?
Is it as big as the hill?
I think so. The hill that I use is right in the middle of a city called Westwood.
Is that right?
Yeah.
My God.
The university in California, UCLA. And when I go back, I'm going to go out, and if I can take a picture of the hill, I'll send it to you.
I wish you would. That would be amazing.
Because this is a perfect.
Well, this is all of this subconsciously. Your film has appeared in.
Well, let's say in all of us, we have, I'm sure that the painting that I almost bought of yours once, I love very much, is it called Land Sale?
Public Sale with a muddy road in the foreground.
I'm sure I can point out War and Peace and the muddy roads.
Muddy road. Isn't
and
that
the wagons and the rear of the wagons.
Sure, that's it.
And
so that
these subconscious influences go on all the time.
You never know at the time, and then all of a sudden, for instance, Betsy pointed out the scene in The Big Parade where Jim is up the tree with the water barrel, remember?
Oh,
and
yes,
he's sitting up there.
Yes.
I can show you a painting which is owned by Joseph Levine called The Afternoon Flight of a Boy Up a Tree. Here it is.
Yeah.
Apple tree.
Yes.
Isn't that strange?
Yes. So I suppose all of life is we sort of like one tremendous family, and we all pick up ideas from the other that just goes on. All of life. You see somebody doing something, and see some gesture or something.
Now, there's one thing I wanted to talk to you about. The girl that Justine.
Yes.
Now she looks a little dated in the film, and yet Melisande is not dated at all. Now, why is that?
Well, Melisande is down to earth, simple, and the headdress, and the way her hair is pushed back.
It fits right in today.
Well, cutting
except
out...
Except that she's a little more voluptuous.
Yes, that is, regretfully so.
Well, listen, I'm sick of the skeletons walking around.
What you say fits in today.
Yeah.
I say they're not quite as voluptuous
no,
today.
No, no, they're skeletons.
So that's why I said regretfully. But her hair is pinned down with a cloth, and her, and she's simple, but the other girl's just been to the hairdresser, you
isn't
see.
That interesting?
And that's what dates it, the style of hairdressing.
It's strange what does date things, isn't it?
Hairdressing does tremendously, and some clothes. But I agree with you that the girl is dated a bit. And
but you can't say that about Melisande.
No, not at all. And when the fellas get into uniform...
They're not dated.
No, they're not
but
dated.
But they're dated when they're in their clothes.
Automobiles.
Isn't that strange?
Automobiles date thing. And clothes style.
Well, you know, if I put automobiles in pictures, which I've done, it does date them right away.
It does.
Then it's a strange thing.
If you want to make it a period thing, fine. That's
yeah, sure.
Do. But if you don't... If you want to keep it contemporary, leave it there.
Now, we're going to be dated here by this car I'm in.
I don't know. The Stutz is pretty immortal.
I brought some stills from California of one of your favorite films, Big Parade, and you might enjoy it looking at some and talking about some of
this. Here we are. Remember this. Man, marvelous.
That's one of the shots you liked.
Terrific. Just great.
But we had four cameras on the shot. We used to use four or five cameras, get a lot of angles.
There they are, Jim. Mm-hmm. Getting a rest before the charge.
Right.
Cigarette lighter. Yeah. Now he's passed
that's
a cigarette.
Right. Well, that's
a marvelous.
Yes,
that's right.
They stopped that's, for 2 months.
That's terrific. Now, isn't that a setup, or is that actually cut out of the film? It almost looks like this. I don't remember that.
No, it's photographed while the scene is going on.
Is it really?
Yeah.
How did you get the smoke effect?
They have smoke pots and men that can create special effects just the way you want it, and lighting and explosions just the way you want it.
Just fantastic. Was this done inside?
It's done in the studio grounds, in the studio lot.
God, and here's the scene. Well, this is one of the legs, the Gilbert's one leg. I was interested how long you could keep it strapped up because it's
certainly... Well, it was strapped hard and tight, and he would do a scene, and while we were changing the lights for a new setup, we'd take the straps off and let him straighten his leg out.
But it looks like a pants over it. That's amazing.
Well, it is. It is sewed up or pinned up in the back.
And that was a very good start, a very difficult one. He talked to Lon Chaney, who had done something like that.
And so he got the idea. These two were marvelous, the Dane and this man.
What else do we have here? I don't want to bore you with
no, all. No, you don't bore me. Gracious. I think that's a great shot. And you said this was done on the lot. Here they are in the shell holes.
Yeah.
And you said it was photographed at night.
Yes, actually at night. We worked all night. And if dawn came up, we'd have to quit.
It
wasn't as cold as this is here in Chad's Ford.
What time of year was this?
I don't remember, but it hardly gets... Oh, we have cold nights. We get cold at night. We'd have fires around to help and keep warm. We'll skip over and go to the chewing gum scene, because there's one in there which he's holding the gum out.
Yeah, this one.
That was ad-libbed right off the...
You saw someone there that was chewing gum and got the idea for doing it. Great.
And the fact that they couldn't speak the same language helped the pantomime.
Of course it did.
You know, and I thought afterwards, the way to do silent films is to have them that they can't speak the same language.
Yeah, that's
and then you have an excuse to do all the pantomime. But pretty soon, sound came along. And,
yes.
And as you said, they often say too much.
I think so. I think the silent films have... you notice, I recently saw a film by Brando in which I realized that his power is the fact he doesn't say much in his films.
He says
very little.
I never had realized that. He
turns his back to the camera and says very few little.
Uh-huh.
He lets other people do all the talking. And he almost is more expressive.
Uh-huh.
He would have been a good silent film man, I think.
Yes. I watched that for him. Maybe he's smart, and he said, I'm going to take advantage of silent acting.
In fact, that's a good idea anyway. Let other people do the talking.
Right.
You
right.
don't get into much trouble.
Right. You don't put your finger
particularly
in.
With women. Maybe we shouldn't put this in here.
Every time you open your mouth, some of us will put our foot in it.
That's right.
Well, we don't have to go through all of these.
This is the one that I think is fantastic. That scene there before the charge,
mm-hmm.
and they come down that curving road with the motorcycles and the French officers sitting, that's a great scene. I think the feeling of that valley, the mood of it, it's really set.
And it was done right near Los Angeles in the famous Griffith Park.
Is it still there, the place?
Yes, still there. I'll go out and have a look and see if that road's still there. It'd be interesting. I don't know whether the road is there. But it's something about that with the trees and the curve of the road.
And the very feeling of foreign feeling, too.
Uh-huh.
It's amazing.
And that's when we weren't allowed to go too far away. Although I went to Florida for a picture before this.
Now, how about all your uniforms? Where'd you get those?
Well,
from the Army?
Well, I think we got those at the costume company there. But you know, we used fellows that had been
in the World War,
because they were already drilled and already knew what to do, and already in platoons and
terrific.
Knew exactly what to do.
macabre feeling.
I got a kick out of where they don't stop to take the jammers apparently.
I know, go right on through them. I think it's marvelous. Yeah, that's great.
It shows that they're not going to belittle themselves to even stop.
No, just terrific.
Did you notice the one where the officer runs up, throws some hand grenades, and then throws his gun at them? He shoots at them. He
turns. That's right, yeah, and then throws again. That's
when he shoots two or three shots with the guns, and then he takes the revolver and throws the revolver at them. I guess he's run out of shots. But I got it. Well, somebody told me they saw that. We were over in Detroit, and this friend of mine named John Darcy wrote this, and I'd like to read it. It's right in line the thing we were talking about, metaphor. It says, art constantly reminds us of the benefits of recognizing and evaluating relationships. It's a good thought.
It is good. That's excellent. Very fine.
It's right in line with what we were saying about the bigger meaning that each of your painting has. This a little more. The artist has the ability to introduce us to ourselves in an acceptable way. Introduces to ourselves in an acceptable way. Mm-hmm. It also enlarges our own perception of ourselves. Mm-hmm. This man, being a psychiatrist, he's interested in that. His skillfulness, the artist's skillfulness in getting us to conceive our human nature broadly, is a great contribution to the sum of human control. A work of art serves to cure us of our littleness and narrowness of mind by reminding us of the higher attributes to truth, such as genuineness, economy, beauty, justice, simplicity, individuality, and content. Now that's right in line with...
Well, this is the type of thing the artist, certainly you, have done it, and I certainly have endeavored to do it. I'm afraid that much art has misses this quality. Don't you agree?
No, not yours. It's all through your painting. It's all through your painting.
Wow.
That you can stand and look, and then it. I'm looking at one right now that it just goes on, and you keep thinking. And I was looking at a Chagall one time, and I had the same feeling. Every one of yours, that just keep with it a little while. Don't just look at it in glancing, by. Stay with it a while. Maybe.
Well, that's why I said that I could. I've looked at your film, The Big Parade, many, many times, because one look is not enough.
Yeah, well, that's what I feel about your painting. It begins to come over you. It comes to you. All these other meanings come to you.
That's
I had
right.
to write a thing for a friend, one of Chagall's, and I had to look at it for maybe 15, 20 minutes before I was able to write. And I feel that...
Well, I think this is true, and I think today with all of our speed of living, traveling, and all the things that we have to distract us.
Yes.
I think this is something we've sort of lost the capacity to dream and let a thing soak in.
Yes, exactly. Well, I know we agree on that, on the deeper meaning.
And that's why I feel very strongly about silent films. I think they did give you a chance to dream as you looked at them.
Exactly.
Today we're almost told too much.
I suppose that the friends we meet through the language of artistic expression, we have known a long time before we first see them face to face. This is certainly the way I felt about Andrew Wyeth, who made me believe there are many similar encounters to look forward to.